Alright, got another gun review here for you guys. And what you're looking at here is a 1911, chambered in 45 ACP. And this here is an interesting version of a 1911. It's a full-size model, basically a government model. And it says here on the slide, right there as you can see, Remington Rand Inc., Syracuse, New York, USA, which is good. That's a good thing. It's an old Remington. But on the frame, if you look right there, it says Essex Arms Corp., Island Pond, Vermont. And so basically this is a gun that's been pieced together a long time ago. The Remington Rand slide mounted on an Essex frame is not really worth a whole lot. I looked on GunBroker and they're selling for about anywhere from $300 to $500. So if you have one of these, you know, you don't really have a collector's item.
You could talk for days, if not years, about these guns because there's just so much history behind them. They've been in service with the military for, what, 70-something years? And they're still one of the most popular guns on the planet. So there's a lot of history and details that goes along with this. So I'm not going to sit here and try to educate you on all that stuff. I'm just going to talk a little bit about the 1911 in general and this particular model in general. So as you can see, it's a full-size gun. I believe that's a 5-inch barrel. And like I said, it has a Remington Rand slide on a Essex frame is what they call it. So anyway, it is a nice gun nonetheless. The guy who owns this is a buddy of mine. And yeah, he bought this for $275 when he was in the U.S. Army back in the mid-1980s. I think he said 86. And some other soldier was hard up for some cash. And he lent it to him. And this was the collateral. And I guess he got to keep the gun. The guy never paid up. So not a bad deal for him. $275 for this gun is not a bad deal at all. And as you can see here, it comes with target sights, actually. Look at that. And if you look up close, it's got that bright orange stripe on the front. And that front sight is actually welded onto the slide. I took this gun apart and looked at it, and you could tell from underneath that it's been welded on there. And then this rear one here is just tapped in. That dovetail groove right there. It's got the spurred trigger, or I'm sorry, spurred hammer. Duh. There you go. So it's kind of an old school spurred hammer, which is nice. And it's got the government style safety lever, which is very strong. I've had other 1911s before where that was a little loose, but this one is very, very solid. I like that. You know when it's on and you know when it's off. Let's see, it's got Packmeyer grips, which is pretty common with these Remington and Essex builds. For some reason they all came with these old Packmeyer grips. This one doesn't even have the gold medallion on it, which is nice, I guess, because you don't have to worry about it falling off. And it does have a little bit of a pinky shelf on the bottom there. That's pretty cool. Another thing that you'll notice about the 1911, at least these GI style 1911s, is that it comes with just your standard vertical slide serrations. There's nothing fancy here at all. They're not slanted, they don't look like scales, and there's no forward cocking serrations. It's just clean, smooth, and simple, just enough to get the job done and nothing more. And that's what I like about these older style GI models. GI style models is that they're basically bare bones. It does not have a flared and lowered ejection port, and a lot of the newer ones will have a lowered and flared ejection port just for more reliable extraction and ejection. That is what they call a full-length guide rod. And do you need that? No, you don't need it, but it is nice to have. Some people just like to have the more modern full-length guide rods on their 1911s, and I don't blame them. It does probably give more value to the gun and probably more slightly better reliability. It does make it a little bit more of a pain to field strip, but not much. I mean, the gun itself is not the easiest gun to field strip anyway, so adding another two or three steps is not a big deal. And even field stripping these 1911s, they're not really that hard to take apart. I'm just saying that because I'm so used to Glocks. You know, Glocks field strip in what, 2 seconds? So yeah, there is a little bit of a manual labor you have to invest to field strip these guns.
It's got your standard slide lock or slide release, depending on what you guys want to call it. It's not extended, so it's just standard. Some models you'll see that they'll be oversized so you can hit them easier, or extended so you can hit them without releasing your master grip. See how I have to release my grip to reach it and then go back to my regular grip to shoot it? I can't reach it just by shooting it. I'd have to release my grip and go like that to release it. This is just your standard one. It's got your standard mag release, nothing fancy there. No flared mag well, just your standard GI mag well. It does have a lanyard loop, so you could attach a lanyard to it, and if, so like if you're climbing or jumping or parachuting or whatever and your gun falls out of the holster, you won't lose your gun. It'll still be attached to you somewhere dangling, which you know, makes sense. The back strap is a raised hump style back strap. It's not a flat mainspring housing, I guess you could say. On 1911s, they call them mainspring housings. They don't call them back straps, as far as I know. I'm not a 1911 expert. I'm just telling you what I know. So if I say something wrong, please correct me in the comments below. The trigger cannot be pulled unless you have a full grip on that frame. See that right there? You have to have a full grip there to pull the trigger. I'm not going to do that because I don't have any snap caps. But that's basically that's something that some people like, or some people hate. Just depends on the person, I guess. The beaver tail is just your standard GI style beaver tail. That's not huge. Some competition guns or custom 1911s will have a huge beaver tail here that actually curves up and protects your hammer spur. This one doesn't have that. And some people say these style of 1911s will actually allow some of your skin to get bit by the hammer, and that's called hammer bite. But I've never had that happen on any of the 1911s I've ever shot. So I guess I just don't have enough meat on my hands to do that. The trigger is very, very small. Look at that. On a normal 1911, it'll come out about half an inch here. This one is very low profile. I forgot what that's called, but I like it. It's very short. I'm assuming the trigger pull is very short on this.
All right, the magazine that it comes with is I believe this is a 7-round magazine, and you can hold one in the chamber for a total of 8. And it's just your standard, you know, steel magazine, nothing fancy to it. And if you know anything about 1911s, you know that 1911s can either be incredibly accurate and expensive and fancy and all this stuff, or they could be Frankenstein, you know, beater guns that you know, just are cheap. So they run the whole gamut. And my point is no matter what kind of 1911 you get, your reliability will probably lie somewhere in your magazines. And I highly recommend getting very high quality magazines if you're going to carry a 1911 for self-defense or duty or whatever. Home defense and whatnot. Get some Wilson Combats or something like that. Because, yeah, these magazines can just be junk sometimes. Also, 1911s shoot the 45 ACP round, which is a big round. And when they first invented these 1911s, they were intended to shoot ball ammo, which is exactly what it sounds like. A big ball was here. There was no hollow point in the ammunition. So the rounds would feed very reliably because they're just a big round ball, and they would slide up into the throat of the chamber, no problem. But with the advent of modern hollow points, this big hole here is basically a big speed bump sometimes, and they can get jammed up inside this older gun and cause a malfunction. And you don't want that in a self-defense gun or a duty gun. What I recommend is you either use ball ammo all the time, just high quality ball ammo, Or you use Powerball. I forget who makes it. Powerball, Corbon Powerball. There you go. And what it is a hollow point with a polymer round tip that makes it the silhouette of a ball ammunition. But when you shoot the round out of the gun, it hits the target and the polymer tip disintegrates, and then the hollow point takes over and just mushrooms like your standard hollow point. So those are very good to have as a defensive round, in my opinion. I don't even know what grain this is, but it's a Federal 45 Auto. It's kind of cool. It's got some type of core. I don't know if that's a steel core or what, but it looks pretty wicked, huh? All right, so that's my review of the 1911 chambered in 45 ACP and this specific model, which is the Remington Rand / Essex 1911. All right, guys, hope you enjoyed it. Stay safe.